Hello, Vital Sign. Today we're going to examine an important property of graph powers. If you haven't already, I suggest you watch my first video on graph powers for background information. To recap, the kth graph power is an operation on graphs that takes as its input some undirected graph and outputs a new undirected graph with the same vertex set as the original one, but in which two vertices are adjacent if their distance is at most k in the original graph. For example, if we have a graph like this, to find its second power, we would copy its vertices over here, connect them all as they were in the original graph, and then connect vertices whenever they were two steps apart in the original graph. The kth power of a graph G is notated like this, using superscript notation. The property we'll examine in this video is repeated powers of graph. Let's look at a motivating example. Say we have a graph G, and we take its second power. Next, suppose we take the second power of that graph. The resulting graph is equivalent to the fourth power of G. Generally, if we take the kth power of a graph and then take the jth power of that graph, the result is the k times jth power of the graph G. In other words, we can multiply the exponents when we take repeated powers. This is like how if we have a number a and take its bth power and then take its cth power, we get the number a to the b times cth power. This is called the power rule for exponents. Why does the power rule for exponents also apply to graph powers? Well, remember that when we take, for example, the second power of a graph, all vertices that were at a distance of 2 from each other in the original graph become adjacent. So the shortest path between two vertices in the original graph becomes shortened by about a factor of 2 in the second power of that graph. For instance, vertices A and E were 4 apart in G, but only 2 apart in G squared. Suppose we have some graph G, and we listed out the shortest path between two vertices, U and V, as a list of vertices, numbered 1 to n, where 1 is U, n is V, and the numbers in between are the intermediate vertices visited in the shortest path. The length of the shortest path is n minus 1, as that is the number of steps needed to get from 1 to n. Now when we take the second power of this graph, we are allowed to hop from 1 to 3, from 3 to 5, and so on, all the way to n, as each pair of vertices 2 apart in the original list are now adjacent in the second power graph. Also, we can hop no further, because if we could, that would imply that some two vertices 3 or more positions apart in the original list were actually closer than 3 steps in the original graph. Yet that contradicts our assumption that the list we started with was actually a shortest path in the original graph. For example, if 1 was only 3 steps from 5 in the original graph, maybe because vertex 3 was adjacent to 5, we could have just shortened the list to find an even shorter path between vertices U and V. But that's a contradiction because our original list was assumed to represent the shortest path. Moving on, if the length of the original shortest path between vertices U and V was even, meaning that the nth place in the list was an odd number, then the length of the shortest path between vertices U and V in the second power is half of the length of the original shortest path. On the other hand, if the length of our original shortest path was odd, meaning that the n in our path list is an even number, then the length of the shortest path between U and V in the second power is the ceiling of half of the length of the original shortest path. You can think of this as shortening the original shortest path by approximately a factor of 2, as path lengths must be whole numbers. Generalizing, when we take the kth power of a graph G, then the distance between any two vertices, U and V, is reduced by about a factor of k. This is because in the kth power of G, We can skip k steps at a time through the path that was once the shortest path between u and v in the original graph, until we get to the point where we are less than k away from v, from which we could then skip whatever remaining distance there is to get to our destination vertex. Why could we skip the remaining distance? Because in the kth power, two vertices are adjacent if they are most k apart in the original graph, meaning that there are many more edges than the ones I've drawn here. And this vertex is, by definition, less than k apart from v or n in the original graph, meaning that they are adjacent in the kth power. Summarizing, if the distance between u and v was d in the original graph, the distance between them in the kth power graph will be the ceiling of d over k. How does this help us prove that the jth power of a kth power of a graph equals the k times jth power of that graph? Well, what does it mean to take the k times jth power of a graph? It means to connect all pairs of vertices that are at most kj apart in the original graph. Any pairs of vertices that were farther than kj apart in the original graph remain non-adjacent. These are precisely the adjacencies we get when we take the kth and then the jth power of a graph. Here's why. Suppose we had two non-adjacent vertices, u and v, that are exactly kj apart in our graph g. By taking the kth power of this graph, from our previous result, we know that the distance between u and v is shortened to the ceiling of k times j over k, which is just j. Now by taking the jth power of this graph, we find that u and v are adjacent. Now what if u and v were some number d less than k times j apart in the original graph? Then again, by our previous result and taking the kth power, the distance between u and v is shortened to the ceiling of d over k, which we can refer to as some number d sub 2. D sub 2 is less than or equal to j. This is because since d is less than kj, then the ceiling of d over k is less than or equal to the ceiling of kj over k, meaning that d sub 2 is at most j. That means that when we then take the jth power of this graph, the two vertices u and v will be adjacent as well. Finally, if u and v were some distance d farther than k times j apart in the original graph, then the distance between u and v in the kth power must be strictly greater than j. If we then take the jth power of that graph, linking all pairs of vertices at most j apart, we find that u and v remain non-adjacent. Therefore, if we take the kth power and then the jth power of a graph, what we get is a graph where all pairs of vertices that were less than or equal to kj apart in the original graph are adjacent, and all pairs that were more than kj apart in the original graph remain non-adjacent. Those are exactly the same adjacencies as found in a kjth power of the original graph. Therefore, the two graphs are equal. Note that the power rule for graph exponents, along with the commutativity of multiplication, implies that the order of the powers does not matter either. G squared cubed equals g cubed squared. Also, we could take three or more repeated powers, such as g squared cubed squared, and it would still be the same as the 12th power of g. That's it for this video. In my next video, we'll take a look at walks, trails, paths, cycles, and circuits. And in future videos, we'll apply these concepts to a fascinating topic called Hamiltonian paths and Hamiltonian cycles. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment if you liked the video. Have a great day.